Hi, I'm Amy, she, her.
And I'm Sophie, she, her.
And this is the Bad Form Takeover of Fluff,
the podcast about friendship, love, unfortunate failure, and fun. Hi, everybody. I'm Sophie. I'm a feminist researcher. I study sociology at Goldsmith currently, and I'm here with Amy today.
Hello. Hi, I am Amy. I am an editorial assistant at Penguin Random House, and in my spare time, I run a magazine with Sophie called Bad Form.
And Bad Form is a magazine about books. It's a literary review. And it talks about books and loads of other things. But before we jump into that, let's do a little fluff classic. What are we drinking today?
So I am drinking a very classy glass of Chardonnay. In a by classy, I mean it's in a literal glass, not a wine glass. So not particularly classy, but we do. What are you drinking, Sophie?
I'm drinking one of my favorite summer soft drinks, which is, it's a hibiscus drink. In Senegal, we call it bisap, but I know they also have it in loads of countries in the Caribbean. So I'm not going to claim it as a Senegalese drink. That's how I know it. And I'm drinking that with a little bit of tonic.
That sounds lovely.
Yeah. And so another fluff classic, who are we drinking to today, Amy?
Today we are drinking to the renowned Toni Morrison, who you may know as an author, but also as a publisher, an essayist, a book editor, and a college professor.
Yeah. So Toni Morrison was born in 1931, and she died in August 2019. So you might have learned about her only then, which is okay. I think that we always put a lot of shame on people for not knowing who people were before they died. But you know what? It's better to know who they are than to know nothing, in my humble opinion. So she was a publisher for a long time before she started writing. She published her first novel at 39, which I think is great to remember, because people often stress about doing everything too late. And Toni Morrison was brilliant, and she only wrote her first novel at 39. And before that, she published with, she was an editor at Random House, and there she published loads of amazing people such as Chinua Achebe or Tonika de Bambara or Angela Davis. And actually, she is the one thanks to whom we've got Angela Davis's incredible autobiography. And last year, I was so lucky to go to talk with Angela Davis, and she was saying that without Toni Morrison, she would have never written it, because she said, I'm only 26, no one wants to hear about my life, people are going to want to know like what I like drinking and who I date. And Toni was like, no, you can write about whatever you want. And that's what she did. And so I think, yeah, that's like an amazing thing to do from an editor, I guess. It's kind of the goal.
Yeah, truly amazing. Like, what a pair, honestly. What a history. But you also might know her from her novels. So her first one was The Bluest Eye, which was featured on the Bad Form reading list, if you've not seen it, which was followed up by The Song of Solomon in 1977, which also won her the National Book Critics Circle Award. And then she actually won her Pulitzer for Beloved in 1987, which you may know from the film, which has Oprah Winfrey as a star. And she also won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1993. So just a, you know, very low-key career, low-key author. But no, truly, truly incredible author. If you haven't read, for example, The Bluest Eye, I would just highly recommend it. There is just nothing quite like it as a book. I can't really compare it to anything. Her writing style is just so excellent. It's so readable, yet so visceral. Unreal. Really worth a read.
And she's one of the only people that I've seen come up so often as well in the rest of what I study. So I, as I said, I do sociology, and Toni Morrison is especially beloved, is always quoted by researchers all the time, be it to talk about feminism, to talk about haunting, to talk about transgenerational trauma, anything really. They're always drawing on her work, which I think also comes to testify to how good it is or how powerful it is.
Yeah.
To Toni.
To Toni.
All right. So maybe, Amy, we should start by introducing Bad Form for the listeners who might not know what Bad Form is.
Absolutely. So as we mentioned earlier, Bad Form is a literary review magazine. So what that essentially means is that we review books, but we also include essays and short stories and also poetry by young people. Previously, we would have said people of colour, but as we'll come on to in a minute, we don't use that term anymore. We say young people who are Black, Asian, Arab, or otherwise non-white. So those people who are sort of chronically underrepresented in the British publishing industry.
Yeah, exactly. And why, I guess let's just talk about it now. Why did you decide to stop using the words BAME or BME, BIPOC, people of color, women of color, and all the other acronyms that I guess maybe that would be helpful to say. So I'm French, and my dad is from Senegal, and my mum is from Brittany, as she would say. She's French.
I am half Indian, and I am half English, Scottish, but I am particularly white passing, just to throw that in there, if you hadn't already seen that from the photo in the show notes. just might be worth mention. But yes, I'm mixed race.
And there you go. So when I say we, that's what I mean. I mean people who aren't white and mm-hmm. come to be known. And there are all those wonderful acronyms, which are much better than what we've got in France, which is, which ones we have? We have people who come from immigration, which I particularly like.
Wow.
Just in general, not white. So they would say like Black and Arabs and French. And French comes to say white. But anyways, wow. We need to find terms to talk about us clearly because, we're a problem.
Need labeling.
Why did you decide to move away from those labels?
Well, actually, it was a pretty recent decision. I'm not going to pretend it wasn't. It was literally something I decided on at the beginning of June. As before, I'd been using BME and POC, so people of colour, pretty interchangeably to discuss anyone who was Black or not white or white passing but brown, and sort of anyone who fit into it. And the problem with that, I was shown through a variety of people sharing resources, especially on Instagram and Twitter, was that it just clumps everyone together into this sort of huge lump of people who are not white. And the thing about that is it does just erase people, particularly Black people, from most narratives, especially in the publishing industry. So, for example, statistic that we used to use a lot, especially as Bad Form, was about BME books and the number of them which have been published. And it was that less than 100 BME books have been published by British authors in 2016.
And although which that's is a, insane.
Which is an insane statistic. But also, it doesn't break it down enough. So how many Black people were published in that period? How many white passing people were published in that period? How many Asian? How many East Asian? It just leaves so many questions. And that's not what we're trying to do with Bad Form. We're trying to lift up and promote people's voices, not just slap them all together.
Yeah. And I think that's such an interesting debate that exists, because on the one hand, you've got the idea of, so that's like one of the concepts that I thought would be interesting to bring in, which is strategic essentialism, which Gayatri Spivak, who's a literary critic, an Indian literary critic, came up with in the 80s. And basically, it's this idea that for the purpose of a struggle or a struggle, let's say you're trying to fight for a specific cause, and so you're going to take the smallest common denominator between you and the people who are fighting with you. So in this case, it would be anyone who's not white. And because you have that experience of being in a space which is dominated by whiteness as a non-white person in common, you can use that to lead your struggle. The same comes for women and feminism. So the idea that sometimes it is useful to use women as a category and to think of cis women and trans women and women of color and lesbians and bisexual women and all of the types of women that you could think about as just under the category woman for a specific political purpose, even if amongst themselves they would be fighting and have different goals and different opinions. Sometimes it can be useful, sometimes it's actually harmful, because what often comes through is that kind of like what Amy was saying with BAME, then you would maybe have a space that still is dominated by the most privileged within this group, mm-hmm. but the problem is kind of dealt with because we've lumped them all together. So, but at the same time, it can also be super useful. And I think platform in that sense can be seen as an instance of strategic essentialism, where we're like, well, we're all not white people in a very white space and we have things to say. And so we're going to make that space for us, for ourselves. But yeah, it's always tricky, isn't it?
Absolutely. And it is a difficult thing. And it's not that I disagree with the idea of grouping together, you know, using ourselves as a group is more powerful. Obviously, that's what we're trying to do with Bad Form. I think there were a couple of things to me which were quite persuasive about remembering that there does exist anti-blackness in pretty much every other minority ethnic or sort of global majority, however you'd like to term it, grouping. For example, I read Bell Hooks's Ain't I a Woman recently. Mm-hmm. And
great book.
I can't believe I took so long to read it, but it was in the Pluto half price sale for not white authors, so I would highly recommend that sale at the moment if you're interested. love a cheap book.
Love a sale.
Especially from Pluto, some great books on their website. Mm-hmm. And it's that idea, you know, like Sophie was just saying about how there is, you know, for example, within the category women, there are some who are, you know, far more historically privileged than others. And also this article in the LA Times from early 2019 by Nadia Wooditala about her experience as a black woman and the terms people of colour and woman in colour. And I'm just going to read a couple of lines from it just to articulate it. And she says, "The terms woman of colour and people of colour are meant to be inclusive, but from my perspective, they only help to leave black people behind, specifically black women. While every minority group faces its own challenges in America, a one-size-fits-all mentality towards diverse erases the specific needs of the most vulnerable communities." And I think especially in publishing, you know, as we're focusing on books, as the magazine mm-hmm. focuses on books, as we've seen, it is black women who get left behind as this sort of push towards diversity is happening. And it costs us nothing to add a few more letters to say these are black people, these are Asian people. We really need to separate in order to unite, if that makes sense.
Yeah, 100%. So I guess that's that about the eternal headache of naming non-white people or anyone outside the norm, really.
Yep.
But I thought something, well, we both thought that something that we could talk about when we talk about books is kind of our own relationship with books. And then we could talk about representation, how that comes in, how you realize that at school you've only ever read white people.
Yes.
As we both have white men, actually, and a couple of white women. So yeah, I guess you go first, because you work in publishing, which I guess is the dream job of any kid who loves books. So go ahead, tell us about Amy and books.
Amy and books. I will admit, I've been very lucky with my job. I got it straight out of uni onto a scheme for publishing at Penguin, and I love it so much. Also, the free books are a great bonus, if you couldn't tell, quite a fan. But, you know, chatting to Sophie about what we're going to talk about for this podcast really had me thinking about, you know, what were the first books that I interacted with, which are my favourites. And the ones that I could really strongly remember, I've pulled a couple out from my mess of a book cupboard. And, you know, one I found was, it's called My Very First Book of Princesses. And yeah, it's pretty basic. And it's retold by Caitlin Matthews, and it's illustrated by Olwen Whelan, who were both, as far as I know, white people. My parents were not particularly strong on sort of ensuring that I read not white people in my children's books. And in fact, I don't know really where they would have gotten those books if they had done. But in hindsight, I actually find it quite interesting that the book I remember most fondly is a book of a collection of princess stories from a variety of culture. We have here on the back, there's a Danish story, a Persian one, one from Akamba, Kalmuk, Chinese story, and a German story. And the cover has lots of pictures of non-white princesses on it. So I just find it interesting that even as a child, those seemed to be the stories that I was reaching for. You know, I had plenty of access to princess books, but those were always the ones I wanted. I think a lot of, you know, not white kids or mixed race kids can remember, especially the Asian ones, reaching for Princess Jasmine with everything they had.
Yes, and that's even more crazy if you think about it. Like, Jasmine and Pocahontas were all I had.
Yeah.
And I was so sad because my hair is, you'll see in the pictures, very curly. Mm. And they had all those, like, those long, flowy, beautiful black hair.
Yes.
And I just thought, God, even the princess that kind of looks like me, she doesn't look like me because she has nice, flowy hair and I don't.
Oh, It is heartbreaking because kids, you know, it's been discussed so many times, but kids do want to see themselves in books. That's who they look up to in their TV shows. And I just feel like books especially, it seems like such a simple idea to put some not white characters in books, and yet there's nothing.
And it is funny because I think also for me, when I did the same as you did, I thought about the books that I really remembered from my childhood. Unfortunately, I'm not at home right now, so I wasn't able to get a hold of the, I mean, even at home, I think they would probably be lost somewhere. But I remember a couple of books really well. And what's interesting is that my mom, on the kind of the opposite of what you were saying about your parents, she always tried, I think, to make sure we were aware and a bit familiar with our Senegalese side, with my sister, and also just in general with not just French and European stories. So through music is something I remember really clearly, that, and I don't think that was on purpose, that's just what we listened to at home. So I listened to a lot of Senegalese music and Youssou and other singers. And then for books, I remember having a couple of books, and one especially, which the legend has it that I knew it by heart, so that was the first book that I pretended to read. And it was about this young boy called Adama Ibulgo, who lived in Ouagadougou, which is the capital city of Burkina Faso. So very far away from my life in Paris. But I just remember reading that and reading a bunch of other books, children's book set in Africa, in various countries in West Africa. And that's just something that really stuck. And interestingly, I think for me, it's when I grew a bit older and I started reading my own books that I stopped having this sort of global outlook. Because then as soon as I started reading my own books and going to the library and borrowing books, I read loads of things about past times, but very little about other places, except for the US. So I'd say, if I'm trying to remember what I read in primary school, the only things that weren't about white people were about slaves and slave people in the US.
Yeah,
and I think it wasn't, I talked about, obviously, I mean, I went to Senegal very often and I had loads of non-white people around me, but not necessarily in school, but just like in out of school. But yeah, in books, it kind of stopped. And I was trying to think about that earlier, how even if it wasn't people who looked like me in the books that I read when I was a kid, like a really young kid, at least it was not just white, French, European people. And I thought, I think that's so, yeah, important. And there are loads of books now being, not loads, more books now being written about trying to channel and platform the experiences of non-white children. I'm thinking specifically of black kids. So in France, we have this amazing author and Afrofeminist blogger called Laurent Safou. I don't think her book has been translated yet. I hope it will be. And she has a couple that just came out, and there's one that's called, if I translate it, it would be Like a Thousand Black Butterflies. And it's about a young black girl who's writing about her hair, and she learns to love her hair. And she has a new one coming out called Jada's Ways, and that one is about colorism. And there's a huge, like, the enthusiasm around her books, at least in the circles that I'm that I know and that I think are interesting, is huge, because there's just a huge gap that she's filling. So yeah,
that's so exciting to hear. Because actually, speaking of new books, I you know, was on the Twitter, I was viewing the social media, and I actually came across Kristen Bell's new book, and I'm not sure if you saw this video, Sophie.
Yes, about the purple kids.
So after participating in the quite incredible I Take Responsibility video this week, Kristen Bell has also taken it upon herself to write a children's book called The World Needs More Purple People. And I'm just going to read out a bit from her video. This is a transcript of her video where she describes what the book's about, if you have not heard of it yet. She said this: similarities exist, and now that we know we're a safe group, we can hear each other out on our differences. That's not explained to kids, she says in her video. So we thought, what if we create a roadmap of a purple person who looks for similarities before differences? And hopefully that will allow kids to have a little more of a social identity and see similarities, and through that have their mind opened by someone they thought were different.
Yeah, thoughts about that. I think what's really interesting is that, I keep saying what's really interesting, that's my problem.
It is quite interesting.
Is that white people, in general, no offense, seem to find it so much easier to talk about how we're all yellow and blue and purple and green and black and white and we're all the same, then they would be about just writing a book about a black kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is so, actually it's perfect as a segue to what we wanted to chat about, which is representation and its discontent. And the idea that writing anything really about how we don't see color is just, I think actually, backtrack, because we think everyone knows this and we think everyone agrees with it because that's what we think. But maybe it would be helpful to talk about why the I don't see color narrative isn't necessarily helpful, or in fact is not helpful at all.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I don't know if you want to say something about it and if I've got...
Yeah, I think the idea of it is that I think people who claim to, you know, not see colour or say I'm colourblind, I don't care if you're black or brown, and then usually they list some sort of not skin colour colours like blue or green or purple in this case. They claim to see past it somehow, that they, through their often white or non-black personal vision, enables them to see through the racial divides that have been created by history, etc. And I think, and you have to excuse my not very technical terms here, the problem with that is that it erases everything about a person's history, their environment, and the societal impact, society's impact on their own lives. So, for example, a black woman has faced issues that a white woman will never, ever have to face in her life. And so by saying to this black woman, I don't see your colour, you are ultimately erasing her experience. Now, Sophie, I don't know if you want to reword that a bit better than I have, but the problem with colour blindness is it does, in fact, leave you blind to who a person is and what they have faced.
Yeah, and in addition to that, it's also this idea, there's a lot of really fascinating work that we can put in the notes about colour blindness, and just the idea that we're post-race or post-racism, and that often goes together. And I think that, I mean, just what you were reading from the video, I can't quote it perfectly, but this idea that we're now a safe group where we can discuss diversity, that's just not true. Mm. And that's not true in, as we can see, in some very violent ways with displays of police brutality and state brutality every day that we witness. I mean, it was the 3 years anniversary of Grenfell a couple of days, yesterday actually. And obviously right now we're in the middle of global uprisings after the horrible murder of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and so many others by the police. And so saying that we're in a post-race society is being an ostrich, is burying your head in the sand and pretending that your life is, you know, somehow post-oppression, which it's not. But also beyond those violent examples, it also allows you to not check any of your bias or privileges, because racism exists in all classes and in all parts of society. And yeah, I think, and if we go back to books and again representation, there are racist ways to be non-racist, and that's something that to try to be non-racist, and that's something that we see in many books, and that I guess we can jump into discussing right afterwards. But basically, if you say you're colorblind, and if you say that you write a book about purple kids because it's a great way to understand that we're all the same deep down inside, you're erasing the problems and you're refusing to learn about the problem, and therefore you can't really move on and get better. I think that's my interpretation of it.
As always, you explain things wonderfully.
Thank you.
No, genuinely, you do. I learn so much from you every day. It's absolutely nuts. Yeah, and it's exactly that. And so to put, you know, what we were just discussing about children's books and this colourblindness, and particularly this idea of purple people, into context. In Britain, a research project funded by Arts Council England found that in 2018, UK publishers published 9,115 children's books. Now, Sophie, I'm going to ask you to guess how many, they've called them BME, characters there were in these children's books in that year.
We said 9,000 something.
9,000 books.
It's definitely under 100, maybe under 43.
Okay, so 391 of those books, that's 4%, featured BME characters.
Oh, but that's not the main character.
Oh, yes, it gets better. Just 1% had a BME main character, and there a quarter of the books submitted only featured diversity in their background casts. So just to think about that, that means that they've, you know, coloured in one of the background kids brown, which I have actually, oh, wow. I have actually not seen but heard about happen in a publishing house, that, you know, being when someone's told that their children's book or illustrated book isn't diverse enough, they color in one of the kids in the background to make it look diverse.
That's the perfect segue to talk about our favorite, everybody's favorite children's book author who keeps becoming, I don't know, she should just, I'm talking about JK Rowling. She just keeps, we're not going to talk about any of her current, how should I call them, achievements. JK Rowling, for anyone who's not aware, has illustrated herself in many ways over the previous years as a tough, trans-exclusionary radical feminist, which, to make a very long story very short, is a group of women and men, but a lot of women, often white, often privileged, often somehow, for a reason that completely I don't understand, in the UK have quite a position of power, and who think that trans women should not be included in the group of women, and who think that trans women's rights infringe somehow on cis women's rights. And JK Rowling is a big, big, tough advocate. But before that, JK Rowling was the author of the book that we all know and loved, I guess, or maybe you hated it, which makes you special, Harry Potter. And in Harry Potter, Amy, please tell us about the diversity in that book.
Oh, it's a fascinating question, isn't it? It's a book that, especially in Britain, we all grew up with. I, for example, went to a school which must have been 50% South Asian, and yet the only South Asian characters were the Patil twins, which, you know, is pretty uncreative as far as South Asian names go. And there was a tweet by Estelle Wesley, I've got Harry Potter on the brain now. That's really terrible. Which I think illustrates this perfectly. And it says this: J.K. Rowling thinking of a name of a white character. Albus Dumbledore, Hermione Granger, Minerva McGonagall. Quite beautiful names, really. And then J.K. Rowling thinking of a non-white character, Cho Chang.
Yeah, that says it all. But in a way, it's super interesting to use her as an example, because it's a book that's set in a wizard world where people have horcruxes and flying horses and a talking hat, and yet they still have, I don't know how to say it, like, yeah, it's still so very, very white and centered around whiteness.
It is a really interesting question, isn't it? Because I think I've seen some arguments going on online. Yeah. Well, the reason this happened is because, you know, magic is hereditary in her understanding of magic, and the people who don't have magic in their bloods but have magic are called mudbloods and all sorts of things.
Yeah.
As if that's some sort of justification. Like, that is fictional, you know? She didn't have to write it.
She picked it. Yeah, and something else that's so interesting is that I've read a bunch of, because you've got some Potterheads who are dead set on defending her forever. When they put on the play about Harry Potter and the, by that time I'd fallen off the bandwagon, so yes. I can't remember the name, but they put on a play that was an adaptation of Harry Potter, and Hermione was played by a black woman, a black actress. And so that caused outrage on the one side, because some people were like, well, Hermione's not black. Let's stop being social justice warriors who, you know, erase white people from all the narratives. But then on the other hand, J.K. Rowling came out and she was like, I never said that she was not white. Ugh. And then people, I remember that really clearly because I was quite offended by it. A lot of people were like, yeah, if you remember in the first books, there's this talk of Hermione having really unruly, big wild hair. So actually maybe we just all missed it, but she was black. And I thought that if that was the only, in a book that describes everything, so like I could tell you off the top of my head 10 years later what the characteristics of each house in Harry Potter is, and like the bad faith that it takes to say that saying she had ugly unruly hair was the same as making one of the main character black is insane. But yeah, that's one way to do representation badly, I guess.
Absolutely. And also to that, you know, to that point, it was so awkward when she made it, because also there'd been so much Harry Potter official cover art, not only in Britain, but throughout the world, where Hermione is depicted as a white woman. And it's not to say that, you know, these characters couldn't be played by a black actress. Obviously, they could, especially when the black actress is Noma Dumezeni, who had already won an Olivier by this point when she was cast, by the way. so it's not like, you know, they just picked a random person. The point is that why ignore that? Why not just acknowledge that a black woman could play this character and it wouldn't really affect anything in this circumstance because she's a witch, a fictional character? I just think it's absolutely beyond that argument needs to be made, that somehow retrospectively she needed to make herself some sort of social justice warrior. I found it bonkers. Absolutely bonkers.
Yeah, but I guess, okay, enough on JK. She doesn't deserve our time. No, but I do think it's really interesting because it's such a big franchise. And then if you think, for me, what always shocked me, and I think maybe it's because I'm from a country that is just really bad at representation and doesn't really care. So I'm not saying that the UK or the US are better, but at least they know that if everything they release is 100% white, someone is going to say something, which, especially now, maybe a bit less when we were growing up, but I did definitely see it when some of the background characters just randomly swapped, and then you could see, so I can't remember which one it is, Dean, I think is his name.
Yeah.
And he was played by a white kid, and then he was played by a black kid. And that happened, or like, I remember when I read The Hunger Games, same, in The Hunger Games, they didn't really say anything about race, which it was just race blind. And then in the movie, they made one of the districts black, which then it added this whole, I guess, reflection on segregation within this world or something. But again, it felt like it wasn't completely thought through. And it's just, yeah, I just always noticed that when you don't think about representation, you just end up, I don't know, giving a big mess. and that shows with the names that we were talking about. It shows with then the problems when you actually have to show it visually and you can't just avoid and color in a kid on the cover. And yeah, and I think if we move just slightly away from children's books or like teen books, actually, yeah, maybe we could talk about teen books as well, because we've started, and then we can talk about representation in,
yeah, I think it's really interesting actually, because I've just looked it up and I remembered an article from many, many years ago when Rue was first cast in the Hunger Games movie. And it was in the New Yorker, and the article was called White Until Proven Black by Anna Holmes. And the idea behind that is that in a book especially, our assumption going into it is that any character described is white until it is explicitly addressed that character is not white. And I was just thinking, you know, in YA literature, other than, let's say, Twilight, where the vampire,
oh yeah, Jacob is Native American,
and you know, all the vampires are very, very white, and we discuss very often in the books that they are very, very white, there is a general assumption in at the very least British literature that a central character is going to be white unless they're described as having, for example, chocolate, caramel, some other sort of confectionery coloured skin. And that's, I think, that ties back to our earlier discussion about people of colour and BME. It's all about this assumption, especially in publishing, that white is neutral and anything else not white is somehow divergent, or it's a good, you know, white, yeah, one right there.
Just others, yeah. And this othering, exactly, and this exoticizing, I guess there's a book by Edward Said called Orientalism, which is a brilliant read. It's a bit, I don't actually remember if it's a bit of a headache. I don't think so. It didn't strike me as a headache when I read it in my first year of uni.
I don't think it was a headache.
No, me too. But I mean, some of them are really good, but I wouldn't recommend because they're just really hard to read. And I don't think that one was. But basically, his argument in the book is that the way that the West and the East were co-constructed through, I'm doing air quotes, no one can see me, but were co-constructed during colonization and throughout history, was a way that the West, by that meaning Europe, but then now the concept can also be used to talk about the US, to talk about Australia, yeah, mainly that, North America, so Canada as well, Europe, especially Western Europe, and then I guess Australia, and how these places, that historical West, which also has changed a lot, it's not an entity that doesn't move through time, constructed the other, again, air quotes, as the opposite of themselves. And then that's how we came to have this understanding of a weird Orient, which somehow includes North Africa, even though I'm not sure, but it does. And China and India and anywhere that's not. No, because, well, I guess the Orient is not Africa, but the same processes can be applied to how we've constructed Africa or South America. And that way of, I had a point, I swear, that way of constructing these others reflects on the West mostly, again, air quotes. And the image that we had of ourselves is how we, what we used, and we like reversed it and then we applied it to the other. And I think that's something that still exists in literature, where you can just see this phenomena of like exoticization, I can't say that word, and othering, which is just applied, and it keeps going, and it's just this, it's this refusal to do the work to actually give us like fully fleshed out characters. And then that gives us also what you were saying, which is such a great point, which is that in our societies where whiteness is the norm, anything mm-hmm. is always assumed to be white. And that's also the problem, that so as a non-white kid growing up, nothing prevented me from thinking that my favorite character was not white, except that if I wasn't told and guided, of course I was going to assume that they weren't, because no one was in the cultural landscape that we had around us. Mm-hmm. And there were so many words that were used to describe, like you don't have to say that a character is white, but you can say that her skin is so luminous and clear and pearly or whatever, which like you read. And yeah. that to me just reads, okay, she's white. She's got a bright white skin. Because that's how we've written it for years and years and years and centuries, actually. And then, yeah, sorry, that was a bit rambly, but the idea was.
It was not. And again, would highly recommend Orientalism, who, for anyone who is even tangentially interested in this idea of East versus West, or how we've categorized white as neutral. It really is an eye opener. And yeah, I mean, I remember this meme we posted to the Bad Form page, which was another tweet by Kai Choice. And it says, if white people were written in the ways which authors describe POC in novels, she says, Karen wrapped her mayonnaise-coloured hands around the ceramic mug and lifted it to her non-existent lips. Her Tide Pod-hued eyes narrowed when she realised she'd forgotten to ask for a manager. I'm only saying this not to make fun of how white people look. I myself look like a white person. but the issue is that when you do describe black people, South Asian people, East Asian people, that's how it sounds when you read it. But we've been so conditioned to understand that we need some sort of explicit pointing and guidelining towards them being not white. It just seems so,
and because it seems like they're bad words, right? You can't just say black, because black is you've said black, so careful there, maybe you're a racist, which means that then it's fine to say coffee or milk, chocolate or whatever, which in a way is just like another way to. I remember my lovely flatmate who during lockdown, she was reading this book and she told me about an extract, and the extract was some character was talking about another character and described him in the color of like all the soul foods that they wanted to eat. So it was, I don't know, crispy chicken or whatever. And she showed it to me and she was like, oh, look, like it's a nice paragraph. And it's true that the intention of the paragraph was really lovely. But then my first reaction was, oh, God, I hate it when they describe us as food. And then when she was like, oh, yeah, true. Like now that you say it, she was like super open and interested to hear why I thought it was really annoying. But to me, it was just odd because, and then I felt bad because I was like, oh, God, I'm the party pooper because I've said that it was actually shit. But it's not. No. It's just that I think it's lazy. I think we could do so much better. And also, there are so many ways to convey diversity, again, air quotes, that don't go through using cliches or using
even if you're uncomfortable with saying this character is black, because you would never say this character is white, there are ways to use names, names are such a great thing. Like, people have different names because of where they came from. They can at least have different names, and you can just use that. And then people will understand. And if they don't, if they think this name is like really long or sounds unfamiliar, they might Google and then they might learn something.
Mm.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that's definitely something that always strikes me, is how lazy authors can be.
Quite right. And I think as I've begun to work in publishing, and I've not been here by it for a long time by any means, it's been about 9 months. The one thing I've realized is that how many people read a book before it is published? It is not just an author who writes a book and then one person looks over it. No, there's editorial assistants, assistant editors, there are editors, publishers, the people who run the publishing house itself, the marketing team, the sales team, the rights team who are selling internationally. All of these people will read a book. And I'm not saying it's all of their responsibility to recognize that, but when there is a whole system who can read and often does read descriptions like this and continues to publish them, it makes you realize that this problem is systemic. It's not just rooted in a few authors who come from, you know, areas where they don't interact with non-white people very often. It is a fundamental issue of this is how it's done. And there's been this really interesting introduction of sensitivity readers. Into the publishing industry, which I think is a really, it's an interesting question, is that you have someone, for example, if it's a book about a black woman or a black trans woman, let's say, you get a black trans woman who works in books to read through the book and is paid to check that everything is, well, PC, essentially. And although it doesn't become their responsibility to make sure all those changes are made, it's an interesting question, because how can one person read a book and know whether something is innately right or wrong? You can't. You know, one person doesn't have that moral or, you know, political overview of the world. I totally agree with what you're saying, Sophie. It's just, you know, the longer I'm here, the more I realize there are so many people who need to change. It's not just the authors who need to change. It's an entire industry which needs to understand that this is inherently problematic.
Yeah, and I think that reminds me of, in preparation for this episode, I was reading this article by Alexander Chee, mm-hmm. And it was about, so I found it because Galdem, which shout out to Galdem, the best magazine out there
ever.
And they wrote an article, and many of you might have seen Normal People when it came out. It took everyone by storm. I really liked it. I'd liked the book before because I think Sally Rooney has a way to write which is just really gripping. I don't know if you've read it, Amy, have you?
I have read it. I didn't love it as much as everyone else did. I did enjoy it, but it wasn't like the best thing I've ever read.
Yeah,
that's a separate conversation.
But same as you. But anyways, I'll let you say that within the series, there were, as I was watching it, as I normally do now, there were a bunch of red lights that lit up in my brain, because I thought, so there's this one black kid in the town where they are in Ireland. And I thought, you know what, maybe, I don't know much about the demographics in the deep countryside of Ireland, maybe there would only be one black kid. And then they go to Trinity College Dublin, and it's still very white, but I thought, I've been to a university in the UK, they are very white, so fair enough. But then, interestingly, so Marianne, who's the main character, has a bunch of boyfriends. Connell, the other main character, is one of them, and then she has three other boyfriends that are kind of important in the series, in the book. And in the novel, none of them are racialized, or we don't have any everyone's racialized even if you're white, but we don't have any comments on the color of the skin or the ethnicity of any of the characters, except for one of her boyfriends, who's particularly abusive and who's Swedish, I think Scandinavian, I think Swedish, and who is like white as snow and whatever. She writes that. But then in the series, they cast this actor as a mixed race black man. And I remember when I watched it, I just thought, that's the representation we don't want. And I thought that for a while, and I talked about it with my flatmate when we watched it together. And I just saw everyone be really happy about this description of millennial love. And I just, no one wrote about this race thing until Galdem did. And Gal then wrote about the problem of the other in normal people. It's a short read. I recommend it to everyone because I thought it was eye-opening. And in that, they linked the Che article. And in that article, he asked questions, basically. He said that people always ask him for advice on how to write people who don't look like them. And he asked a set of questions. He said that, first of all, because he said that when you give people advice, they don't follow it. They just use it to validate whatever they wanted to do in the first place. So he said, why do you want to write from this character's point of view? Do you read writers from this community currently? And why do you want to tell this story? And so that forces you to take pause as an author and think, all right, why am I telling this? And why do I think it's a valuable addition? But then he said there were three more questions. And those I thought were spot on, which were, does this story contain a damaging stereotype of a marginalized group?
Mm-hmm.
Does this story need this stereotype to exist? And if so, does the story need to exist at all? And I thought that was so important. I don't know what you think, Amy.
It was an incredible article. You're quite right. I mean, Sophie linked me to this article before we recorded the show, and it has just sort of boiled down to its very core the question of why do you need to write this character? Why do you need to write the story? And it's such a simple one, but it makes so much sense.
Yeah. And it was just, and I thought, because in a way, this, I don't want this to come out as, I don't think that we should have only books about Black characters who are flawless and perfect and funny and intelligent and beautiful and successful. However, there is, in the very little representation that we already have, a lot of it contains damaging stereotypes, and a lot of it is already, it's not helpful. I don't think we need that many books about, God, I don't even have an example right now, but any damaging stereotype that you can think of, and then you look at a book and the only character who is not white fulfills this stereotype. And I think that's what was shocking in the normal people one, is that the boyfriend who was the most physically, he was also mentally abusive, but he was, oh sorry, emotionally abusive, but he was also physically abusive to her. And I mean, there was a white boyfriend who was also trash, but there was this Black boyfriend who was more trash. And I thought this, it would have cost them nothing just even to invert it or to let him be white. And I don't think it was a conscious choice. I think the conscious choice was, we need to have a semi-main character who's not white.
Yep.
Except that if you stop your reflection there, well, then you end up with the guy normal people.
It is, and I totally agree with that. But building on that and moving away from it slightly is this idea that people are now starting to reach for particularly Black authors, as they should. There are some excellent Black British authors or Black authors who've been published in Britain. Homegoing by Yar Gyasi, for example, is a fiction book I see floating around a lot, which is unreal. I had so many people telling me to read it, and I finally sat down and read it and couldn't believe I'd waited so long. Really, if you haven't picked it up, you should, preferably from a Black-owned bookshop, which are now open as of today, Monday, 15th of June. plug. But the thing is, people are picking these books up off of anti-racist book lists, which have their own issues, which have been discussed by many outlets in a better way than I could. And that's it. They're picking up books, for example, to educate themselves about anti-racism or about slavery or Black issues, and not changing their reading habits to include not white authors and Black authors, for example, who write about Black joy or just everyday Black life. And that's so important, because
it is,
by reaching only for anti-racist work, you are again reducing Black people only to an educational tool for yourself and not as excellent writers and excellent creators. And reading one Zadie Smith novel does not make your whole bookshop shelf diverse. I'm just going to say that. You can do better. I believe in you.
This is so, everything you just said is so true. And I'm so glad that we managed, because as we were speaking and I thought, oh God, we're not going to say anything positive because we have so many grievances. But yes, this, like, writing, in the past few days, I've been a bit, a few weeks, I've been a bit frustrated when I saw some people who I follow, especially on social media, influencers, bloggers, who are like, yeah, I mean, I'm seeing everything that's going on and I'm going to read Black books now. And I just thought, that's everything Amy just said. But also, this is limiting us to, again, kind of writing, I think, because if we think of publishing as well as an industry, if people only reach for black books who talk about blackness as something difficult, or who talk about slavery, which talk about everything you just said, basically, which are outlets to educate people about racism, those are the books that are going to get a commission, like that authors are going to be paid to write, and then we might just get stuck again in this cycle where there's this majority of like commercial books about blackness that just don't reflect any of the diversity of the black experience. And I just wanted to mention, like, there's this article, the first thing I ever wrote for Batform was about Afropian literature. Mm-hmm. And I wrote about French black authors, black authors who write in French. And that's really important because they weren't French. And I think that really freed them from this white gaze. The two authors I'm talking about, one is Alain Mabankou, who is a Congolese writer whose work was translated in English, at least the one I'm talking about right now, called Black Bazaar. And the other, called Leonora Miano, who's from Cameroon. And her work has, I think only one of her novels has been translated that I haven't read. But both of them, they don't write for the white gaze. And I think I've listened to many interviews of them because I love their work. And both of them always say that they weren't black until they went to France. And I think that was so important because that enabled them to... There are so many people outside of Europe and the US and, I mean, what you said earlier, global majority. There are so many people who live a life outside of the white gaze. It doesn't mean that they're free from white supremacy, but it just means that being black is the norm. If you go to Senegal, being black is the norm. And so you wouldn't write my chocolate skin because your skin is not chocolate. It's just like everybody else's, maybe in a different shade. And reading their books, I always found so freeing. And kind of the same also with some books by authors. I'm being very French right now, but it's because those are the books that really marked me from the French Caribbean. So Marie Scondé was also an incredible author who wrote one of maybe my favorite books, which is called, in English, they called it I, Tituba, Black Witch of Salem. And it's about the witch trials of Salem, but looking... So there was actually a black witch in those trials, and there's almost nothing about her.
I was going to say, I have heard nothing about that.
No.
That sounds fascinating.
So she was enslaved, and then I think she was a servant for one of the families in Salem, but she was also in the trial. And Marie Scondé wrote this book, which is incredible, which is about Tituba, I'm not going to try to say it with an American accent, with an English accent, Tituba's life. It's incredible. But my point is, all of those authors write in a way that for me is so freeing because it's not, I mean, also none of them are in the US. So that's brilliant because I think there are some books that are kind of freed from the white gaze or really exist for blackness and black joy and just black life. But a lot of them are set in the US. And that's brilliant, but that's different from the black experience one might have outside of the United States. Whereas those books are kind of, and that's how I said it was like Afropian literature. I mean, I didn't say that. People say that. It's Afropian literature. It talks about the Afropian experience. And I think those authors in particular are able to write kind of away from the white gaze. And those are books that everyone should read because they just enable us to deconstruct those assumptions that we have. And also they're amazing books. They're just really great stories. They're fun. They're fun in a way that we don't necessarily expect. They have references that we're not necessarily used to. I mean, Mabankou, I love because the way he writes in a Congolese French. He always says that. He says that his French is not so in French, we always say that French is the language of Molière. And he says that his French is not just that. It's also the language of so many other people who are not old, dead, white Frenchmen. And that you can hear that when he writes. And you can. And it's brilliant. So yeah, that's my plug, which is Afropian literature is so important. And literature from black people and other non-white people outside of the US or outside of, first of all, outside of Europe. So I think African literature is so under-regarded. And the same with South, a bit less, but still with Asian literature. I was going to say Southeast, but any Asian literature. And yeah, just read people that are different from you, but that are where you're from. If that makes sense. Yeah, rant over.
Not a rant. And also an excellent, excellent article by Sophie, if I say so myself, available on the website. It's truly a great read. And my quick plug, I'm realise we're very close to the hour being up already, which is yes. very, very fast. Yeah, I'm just going to plug one book. It is called Brave New Words and is a collection edited by Susheila Nasta, who is the editor-in-chief of Wasafiri magazine. So if you don't know it, Wasafiri calls itself a magazine which platforms international diverse writing, encouraging you to travel the world via the world. And to put it simply, basically, it was one of the first literary magazines to really platform Black, Asian, Arab and non-white authors. And it is just the most incredible collection of essays. So just to name drop, so there's essays by Blake Morrison and by Bernardine Evaristo. And essentially it brings together this idea of what brave new words are. And I wrote a review of it and I said, you know, the cynical among you may deem the purpose of brave new words as diversity, but I think it's a lot more romantic than that. Its purpose is to bring you words beyond the collective imagination of a world made stale by the monotony of contemporary literature. And it's a voyage into the world left purposefully unknown by the publishing industry. And it's very, very interesting to read. You know, essay titles include The Good Brown Girl Questioning Obedience in Indo-Caribbean Women. Like, it is just a fantastic introduction to the variety of literature beyond that, which is so often published and publicised in the British publishing industry. It's a paperback. It's a really excellent read. And although it's non-fiction, it is really transportative and transformative. I would 100% recommend you picking that up if you're interested in a sort of, oh, I hate the word diversity, but diversifying your bookshelf beyond anti-racist literature and really thinking about authors you might be interested in reading more from. So that's my plug for adult literature. That's
brilliant. Yeah, we'll make sure to put together a list of everything that we've mentioned in this podcast, and we'll put it on the Bat4 social media or website. So absolutely. If you guys want to go ahead and read more and hopefully love it as much as we do. Which we really do. Amy, please tell us about the last issue of Bat4 and also the prize. Who knows?
Oh, yes. So the current issue of Bat4 came out last Thursday and it's on crime. But before you groan, crime means a lot of things in literature. And actually, we've got a lot of focus in this issue, quite timely, on colonization, the colonial impact of literature, and also stuff on true crime and your favourite old crime books, and then reviews of modern books like My Sister the Serial Killer. It really covers every aspect of what the word crime means in literature. I'd really highly recommend it. We actually sold out of our first and second print runs, so you can now get your copy of the third print run from our website.
Also digital copies if you're outside of the UK. That's what my mum got. So...
And they look great on digital too, I must say. And then also today, which is Monday, we have just launched the Bat4 Young Writers Prize, which is our first Young Writers Prize, I'm really excited to say. Sophie is helping me out with the judging. It's going to be really great. And it's particularly great, I think, because the prize isn't just, you know, sort of the title. The main prize is one-to-one meetings with an agent, who is Catherine Cho of the Madeleine Milburn Agency, a publisher, Joel Richardson from Penguin Random House, and an author, Ukachukwu Nzelu from the book you might know, The Private Joys of Nena Maloney. If you have not read that book, again, you really must read it, as well as you win some tickets to creative writing courses and a huge, huge pile of books, which is currently taking up my desk, actually most of my desk. so can confirm it's a really big pile of books by non-white authors, which is also a nice touch, I think.
So if you're under 25, mm-hmm. And a non-white, Black, Arab, Asian, anything else, I always forget people. So... author, and you don't need to have a full manuscript, right, Amy?
Nope, you just need 1,000 words of it and a summary of 300 words,
and then you can send it over, and that would be brilliant. We would love to read it.
We'd love to support you, and we'd love to offer you the support as well, so please do, and get in touch if you have any more questions about it, but hopefully it should be pretty straightforward to do.
There you go. And then Bat4 is on Twitter and Instagram at Bat4 Review, and we've got our website with articles on there, so please have a look. And I guess that's it for today. Thank you so much for listening.
Don't forget to rate and subscribe this podcast if you love it. I'm sure. Well, I hope you did.
Yeah. And I just wanted to say that. So this was the first takeover of Fluff that Jess and Emma so kindly offered for us to take over the platform and do with it what we pleased. And they really want this to be an inclusive space, to platform a whole range of experiences and opinions. So if you have a project or a topic that you'd like to talk about, if you'd like to be interviewed, if you want to do a collab between Fluff and your own podcast, and you're also from, oh, I don't know how to phrase it. It's so hard when you get rid of the acronyms, isn't it? But if you're also not white, basically, please reach out to them so you can get in touch with them via their social media at Fluff Creatives or by email fluffinquiries@gmail.com. So yeah, that was it for us. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, guys.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening, and don't forget to rate and subscribe.
We're excited to welcome you into our Fluff family and bring you some gorgeous sparkles every Friday.
Oh,